Okay, tonight we're closing out the Walking In series. We're closing out the whole 1st, 2nd, 3rd John books. We're on the letter that's 3rd John. We're on that letter tonight. This message really, I think, is to the point. I think it sums up the entire heart that John had as he wrote each one of these letters. And then tonight, he just brings it in such a way that hopefully we find his encouragement from. And hopefully when we walk away with it, we're actually going to walk away going, oh, I can do that, actually. I got this. I can do this. Not because of our own strength or anything, mind you, but because of the love of Christ that so dominates who we are. I mean, we're so just impassioned by that love. And so, if you turn in your Bibles to 3 John, we're going to start with verses 1 through 4. Verses 1 through 4 of 3 John. The elder, this John I'm just referring to my dear friend Gaius, whom I love in the truth. Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health, and that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along well. It gave me great joy to have some brothers come and tell about your faithfulness to the truth, and how you continue to walk in the truth. And I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. First off, look at what he does to my dear friend, Gaius. Dude, he opens up this whole letter straight out of that going, to my dear friend, Gaius, whom I love in the truth. He initiates right out of the beginning, you are a dear friend to me, and I love you. He makes it personal by calling him by name and lets him know I love you. Do you know how powerful that is? When someone knows your name and they're willing to look at you and say, I love you. I love you. Not some, you know, kind of, love you, baby. But love you. I love you. Do you know how powerful that is? Do you know how much that matters to our souls? Because who doesn't want to hear that, right? Who doesn't want to hear that? Who, when you see, that's why people like, they get all upset when they think somebody's playing a favorite here or a favorite there, because they're going, really, at the end of the day, they just want somebody to tell them they love them. That's what they want. And as Christ followers who have the love of God living in us, consuming us, taking over us, we have the love that God lavished on us, living within us. How can we ever want to hold back such a gift from anybody and not want them to feel loved? And sometimes we're like, well, I show love, so I'm good. Clarify it sometimes too by saying the words. You know what I mean? It's like that thing with the, you know, this man, he's like 75 years old and he's been married for like 60 years. You know, they got married way back in the day. You know, they get married like 14, 15 years old. And his wife looks at him and she's all, Bert, you never tell me I love you. And he just looks at her. I told you I love you on our wedding day. If it changes, I'll tell you. You know what she wanted to know? She wanted to know, do you still love me? You know what I'm saying? Do you still love me? You don't have to say it. I love you. And communicate it. And that's what John does here. He's like, dude, I love you in the truth. I love you in Jesus. And I'm going to tell you, there's a difference between loving in Jesus and loving in your flesh. Hello. There's an absolute difference in that. See, people that love in the flesh, they pick and choose who they want to love. People that love in the flesh, they pick and choose where they're going to focus that love. And then they turn around and have an attitude for every reason why they're not going to love everybody else. That's a confusing love, you know what I mean? That's a confusing love. Let me maybe make it a little bit clearer. Have any of you ever told a lie? Let's be real. We all have, well, the video camera is up here, but basically in this direction, but yeah, okay. We got people that tell the lies, all right? Charlotte, did you write those names down? All right, good, that's good. And have you noticed when you lie, you have to do this one major factor when you lie. Remember what your lie was. Right? You know what I'm talking about, right? Because then you start getting questioned about your lie. And you're like, wait. And you're backpedaling, and you're backtracking, and you're reaching, and you're grabbing, hoping that what you repeat was what you said the first time. You know what I'm saying? I'll never forget this girl. It was hilarious. True story. Those of you that know Emily, the middle school secretary, she married one of my boys from Colorado. He's more more like a little brother than one of the youth kids. Just, I mean, he's a lot older, whatever. But he's so funny. He was our medic on our team. Like, he traveled with us to camps and stuff. And this one girl, like, I am for real. I am for real. She turned around. She said, "My right leg hurts." Because, well, it seemed that Edison, Emily's husband, was a little dreamy. She needed medical attention. So he went to her, took care of her need. You know, like, okay, I got this. And she's like, "Can you help me? It hurts really bad." And he goes, "Okay, well, why don't you go ahead and walk for me? Huh? Well, I just want to see kind of what's going on with it." Okay, mind you, this leg, right? You know, I thought it was your right leg. Oh, it switched. That's quite how it works. Just saying. But we kind of caught her because she kind of forgot, like she got all distracted. Because of her little story that she was making and playing, and it was beautiful. And oops, you know, but it happens. I mean, you guys know that, especially if you're lying with somebody else. You gotta make sure your story is, you know what's crazy? When you're telling the truth, you don't have to worry about the lie, because, well, this is exactly what happened, so I don't have to worry about what did I say, because I'm saying exactly what did happen, so it's all good. Here's the deal. Here's why that's relevant. If you're loving in Jesus, if you're loving others in His name, it's consistent, you know, it's steadfast. If you're not loving in His name, let me help you out. Basically, you're living a lie. If you're not loving in His name, you're living a lie, because, like, well, did I show them love or did I not show? I don't know. Are you walking in His love? We know that He commands us to walk in His love, and love is walking in His commands. It kind of just is that cyclic thing kind of that we talked about even last week. You know, love by walking in His commands. His command is to walk in love. So with that said, you're living a lie. You're not loving in Jesus' name. And so I love what He says. He's like, "Man, I love you in the truth. I love you in Jesus. Know it. Believe it. I don't have to think about, consider how I'm loving you. I'm loving you in truth." And then He keeps going, "Man, I'm praying that you may enjoy good health and all may go well with you." Some commentary people actually think that maybe Gaius was kind of sick. He wasn't really well. Doesn't exactly say that, but I really don't care. He's telling him, "I'm praying you have good health." You know what I mean? I remember visiting with Jacqueline. She would be a senior this year. Met her probably shortly after I got here, maybe within a year after getting here. She ended up dying of a childhood form of cancer. And when she did, I just remember visiting with her and loving on her a little bit. Only knew her, you know, for a few weeks. Really, that was about it. I met her at the hospital kind of thing. But I got to tell you, she was doing a whole lot better than a lot of other people that were around there. And she was close to death door. Her spirit knew who she was with. She knew she was in God's hand. She knew God had her. She knew God had her towards those last days. She said, "I'm praying that you're well." Well, yeah, do we want to pray for a real true healing, physical healing? Absolutely. But the physical healing doesn't even count to the healing that she got in Jesus' name. I remember telling her parents, "You do realize that if she gets up out of that bed and starts walking, that's a miracle. Praise Jesus." And you also realize, if she closes her eyes in that bed, dies here, but next thing you know, she's in heaven with Jesus, that's a miracle too, because we don't deserve to go there. So either way, she wins. Either way, a miracle takes place. You follow what I'm saying? She was in good spirits. Paul said, "Man, I want you to be in that good spirit. I want it to go well with you." You know? And this has been giving me great joy to have some brothers come and tell of your faithfulness to the truth and how you continue to walk in the truth. And I want you to catch this. Now he's saying, by the way, Parker is so cool because others who were around you came to me and told me some things about you that are showing how you're living out the gospel in your life. Two points there. Two really cool points there. People came and told John about his walk with Christ, about him living out that faith. How cool is that? But it didn't just go from a talking behind his back, lifting him up. John wanted to make sure, "I want you to know that you were talked about behind your back in an awesome way." You hear what I'm saying? When you're talking behind other people's back, what you're saying, I hope it's that. I promise you, I will never go, "What are you talking behind their back for?" If you're talking about praise God things in somebody's life behind their back. That's how we need to be talking. Go back to last week when I was talking about that with the gossip issue. You want to stop that? Start building up. You know what I mean? Start building up, and I'll stop that conversation. They may turn it on you, whatever, but you're still doing the right thing, you know? You're still doing the right thing. Here's the deal. Do we talk about people behind their back in that kind of manner? And don't go, well, I just feel awkward doing it. Well, awkward is such a stupid word, it's driving me crazy. But let's get past that. If you see God doing something to somebody, go talk about it. Lift up people. People get talked about in a negative way. No, go talk about praise God things about somebody's life, right? You hear what I'm saying? Going to the positive is not the natural. Go get that. And then, also make sure they know. Make sure they know. I know that there have been times that I've talked about certain people going, man, I just love this about them. I love that about them. And then I think, did I tell them that I love that about them? Because I need to. And then I got to follow up with that. You follow what I'm saying? Here's four things for some of y'all little number takers. Here's what I'm actually giving you points tonight. You're welcome. But here's the deal. What do we get here? First, John, right in these first four verses, he's reminding you. First, remind of love. When you are talking with somebody, remind them that they're loved in Christ. Remind them they're loved in Christ. That's the first thing out of there. Second thing out of there. Specifically, pray for people and let them know how you're praying. You ever had the people praying for you? If they're going to pray for you, hey, what are you praying, actually? For me. Because you ought to know, right? And it also helps you with accountability. Because see, if Jake looks at me and says, hey, praying for you, and I look at him and say, oh, that's awesome. What are you praying to God about me for? What are you talking about me to God for? I love this. Thank you. You know what we're doing? We're crossing over from religiosity to relationship. Hello, baby. We're crossing over from religiosity to relationship. Because a lot of you, let's be real, don't raise your hand, but let's be real. How many of you have spoken out those little random, quick little, oh, yeah, I'm praying for them. Can you talk to God about them, please? Now, you may about some people, don't get me wrong, it's not an all or nothing kind of thing. But you guys know what I'm talking about. I'll never forget, we had this one pastor one time that he had told us, oh, he's praying for us because we're potentially going to leave in their church and go into a church in Colorado. And so we're having this conversation and all this whatever. We'll never forget this moment as long as I live because I saw my wife in a whole different way. Let me just tell you. We're out there talking and he was mad. He was mad that we were, we talked to him about the fact that God was calling us away. We had talked about it. We'd had him praying. Were you praying for us? Pray with us. Blah, 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 blah. Because we obviously want to go where God's taking us to go. If God's calling us, we got to go. We want to obey that. And he was mad, and I was like, this isn't new information. You've been praying with us about this, haven't you? Like, haven't you been praying? And true story, he says these words. You know how it is. Sometimes you say you're praying, but you're not really praying. And Lisa looked and said, actually, no, I don't. If I tell somebody I'm praying for them, I'm going to pray for them. So because of this moment now, I'm going to go ahead and excuse myself and let y'all continue to talk. And she got up and walked away. And she was like, well, I'm not going to play a game. Apparently, I realized that we're not being prayed for. So there's religiosity taking place. She still loved, still gave bugs before we left, all nine yards. But she was like, well, I'm not going to play a game. Y'all, you know one thing I've noticed about this? I didn't grow up in this game. Let me just call that out. I didn't grow up in the church. And this is not about you looking at anybody else that might be playing the game. This is about you looking at you, baby. You looking at you. Have you ever caught yourself playing the game? Trying to make sure you look and sound spiritual, even though it's not quite where you are. Here's some simple, easy ways to take that back. So I'm not going to camp on that. That's not tonight. But I want to camp on this. Be willing to go communicate to people that you're praying for them, and be willing to tell them why you're praying for them. Okay? Be willing to tell them why you're praying for them. To move from religiosity, here's what you do. Legitimately pray for people about specific things going on for them. Like as a benefit. Now, don't pray against someone. Hello. Pray for them. Pray for them. I think if I busted into a prayer time tonight, say, hey, we go. I talked about this Sunday morning a little bit. Hey, I want us to turn around and have a prayer time. So let's get ready to start praying. Everybody start praying. Some of y'all, after about 30 seconds, will be like, well, what are we going to do now? We have tons of stuff we can pray for, let me just tell you. Look in this room alone. Look how many names. Look around this room and think about how many names you know in this room alone. you could probably actually think of things going on in their life where they could use you to pray for them. And if you don't really know a whole lot of specifics to pray for them, pray for who they're with at school. Pray for them when they're at their house with their family. Pray for things that they may be going through with their studies. Pray for people that may be starting to do driving. Pray for those that are on the road because of people that are starting to do driving. You follow what I'm saying? Like, it's not that hard. We make it harder. We always make it like this is what we're trying to get. We want to get really deep. I want to go really deep. Pray and pray specifically for people. That's deep. Get out of the shallow pool and start diving in with some prayers. Take some time in prayer. And when you do, take some time to breathe and listen. Let God speak back to you. There's literally been times where I start praying for somebody because their name's on my heart. And I'm like, God, I'm not really sure why I'm praying for them right now. And all of a sudden, God starts to stir my heart with ways I can pray for them. You hear that? God starts to talk to you when you actually are talking to him. He'll actually kind of lay something on your heart or your mind about why you do need to be praying for them. So pray for them. And don't think about what may be being said. Literally pray that to him. And thank God for them. But be specific. See what I'm saying? That's what he does with Gaius. He's like, dude, I'm praying that it goes well with you. I'm hearing these things. I'm praying. Then, there's a third thing that you get. Go lift up, go testify. Don't lift them up. Go testify about others speaking and living in the faith. People went to John and told them about this guy. What would people come to me and tell me about you? People that are following you around, watching you, what are they going to come tell me about you? You know who has control over that? Guess who? You do. If it's truth. Now, people can lie about you, don't get me wrong. But what are you giving that's truth that they can testify about you for? You follow? But you guys, we need to get in the habit of testifying about others in the faith. We need to get in the habit, practice of lifting up others in the faith. Which may mean you have to watch. Which may mean you have to look around a little bit and go, well, I don't know anything about them, so I can't really testify about them. Easy solution. We'll go deep. If not, that's really deep. Spend time in conversation with them, receiving from them who they are. Don't look for the negative in their life. Look for the positive in their life. You follow? Don't look for the, enough people looking for the negative in their life. They got that covered. You look for the positive in their life. You look for positive ways to spend things instead of negative ways to spend things. You follow? And testify about that to other people. And then, make sure other people know they're being talked about in a positive, awesome way behind their back. You're being lifted up. You're being encouraged. And I want you to know that. You follow what I'm saying? That's what John shows us. And then he keeps going. Oh, can you imagine the fellowship that this would create? Can you imagine what doing those four things would start to make the fellowship of Christ followers look like? Can you imagine that? Hello? Or did I just... Davey, am I the only one in this room? Because it got really quiet. Can you imagine the kind of fellowship that would be taking place if we'd be doing this? Right. No, but true story. That's too bad that that's a true story. Why can we not imagine that, guys? I want to imagine that. Do you hear me? I want you to, man, you better watch out. You go to that church, they're going to talk good about you. You go to that church, they're going to pray for you, but they're going to tell you why they're praying. They know you got a test coming up. They know you're doing driver's ed. They know that you maybe just broke up with somebody. They know that you're trying to be protected from certain other people. They know that this is going on. They know this is going on with your family. They may know that's going on. That's going on. They're going to actually pray for you specifically. People leave that church. Isn't that crazy, guys? Can you imagine what kind of fellowship any body of believers would look like if they started to do this all the time? Got to start somewhere. Somebody's got to lead the way. You know what I mean? So, but then he goes, verses 5 through 8. Dear children, and you are faithful in what you are doing for your brothers, even though they are strangers to you. They have told the church about your love, and you'll do well to send them on their way in a manner worthy of God. It was for the sake of the name that they went out, receiving no help from the pagans. But we ought therefore to show hospitality to such men, so that we may work together for the truth. This one is a little bit trickier for me to actually start to communicate about, because I am one who is sent out in the truth to come lead and shepherd. I am one of the ones sent out to go testify about the gospel. So it's a little bit tricky for me to do it. So imagine this with everybody else. Imagine this for the Disciple Now leaders. Imagine this for people that come in for a camp. Imagine this for whatever else. Imagine this for the Alpha Dean students that, hello, you may or may not have wanted to be a part of because of whatever reason, that's cool. But I'm going to tell you what, imagine them, because you know what? They're still taking time out to try to go back to relationships. They're taking time out to try to be able to bring the word and prepare the word and do things. They're taking time out to serve when they don't have to. Think about this with them. I'll read it again. Dear friend, you are faithful in what you're doing for the brothers. He's now starting to be faithful for how you act towards them, okay? You don't have to really know them. I don't know them that well, but that's okay. We should be treating everybody in the same kind of love. They've told the church about your love. You'll do all this in a manner worthy of God. It was for the sake of the name that they went out, receiving no help from the pagans. We therefore show hospitality to such men so that we may work together for the truth. He's saying basically, dude, people that are out there preaching the gospel, speaking the gospel, that come to minister to you, to serve you, they're not doing that so you'll turn around and figure out whatever else you want to think or say about them in any other form or fashion. They're doing that for you because they want you to know this. I promise you, I do not do this job for the money. Let me be crystal clear. I do not do this job for the money. At all. Because one word I'm going to say, what money? That's not why you do it. That's not why you do it. You follow. And what he's saying is, man, you're treating them right. I love how he's focusing on a positive here. He's not calling out the ones yet that are doing it wrong. He's calling these ones out that are doing it right. He's like, man, they see how you just love them, how you want to turn around and really just help send them out in more love. Hey, oh, you got to go there now to go serve? Praise Jesus, let's go. Go on and do it. We're going to support you. We're going to pray for you. And he said, they're not accepting anything from the pagans. They're not accepting anything from the lost. So we got to come alongside of them and give. We got to come alongside of them and help breathe into them. Give them, you know, when we send people out, like missionaries that go to Uganda, we're like, hey, I want the team to do missionary bags for the teams that go into Uganda, to go to Everett. Here's why. Because I want the ones that are going to serve on mission to feel loved by those who sent them out, which are those in this room. And I want them to feel loved. And honestly, I could care less if I get a bag, because on one of the trips, guess what? I didn't. But what did happen was we made sure that everybody, including last-minute sign-ups that were very last-minute, they got something. Because it was one of those kind of things. They need to know, you are loved. You are blessed. We're sending you out in love. See, it shouldn't be about if you're getting it. It should be about if you're giving it. Do you follow what I'm saying? Not about if you're taking it, but are you giving it? And that's what I said. You guys are giving it. You guys are giving it. How awesome is that that you're making them feel that love? And then what do they do, by the way? Oh, those people are going, you definitely want to go to that fellowship of believers, because let me tell you how they love. Go back to what I said a minute ago. Wouldn't it be crazy to be that kind of fellowship that's talked about like that? Got to start somewhere. But being loved in the truth. And then, now he gets a little bit off. Goes a little bit off. Verse 9. I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, where they got these names back in the day, let me just call that. I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to be first, will have nothing to do with us. So if I come, I will call attention to what he's doing, gossiping maliciously about us. Not satisfied with that, he refuses to welcome the brothers. He also stops those who want to do so and puts them out of the church. Dear friend, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. Anyone who does what is good is from God. Anyone who does what is evil has not seen God. Demetrius is well spoken of by everyone, and even by the truth itself. And we also speak well of him, and you know that our testimony is true. He gives us the one real big command. He gives us that in this one. But catch this first. He's saying, here's Diotrephes, who loves to be first, who wants nothing to do with the truth. He doesn't want it to be out there. He doesn't want to accept this. He doesn't want to accept the brothers. And that's not enough that he doesn't want to accept the brothers. Hear this. He wants to turn around and stop others from accepting from the brothers and the love. Basically, it's one of those things. Why are you being their friend? You see what I'm saying? Hello. Let's make it a little bit relatable. Who loves to be first? Look at me. I look good. I am the one in Jesus. Don't let them in, though. Now, catch this, what John says. John said, I'm going to call that out. a few people. Mm-hmm. John, the elder, got some spiritual maturity behind his years. Do you follow what I'm saying? He's got some spiritual authority. Do you hear what I'm saying? Well, they need to be praying. He is making it clear, I'm going to call this out for what it is. And some people, well, why is he judging Diotrephes like that? He's not judging. It's fact. These things are happening. And at some point, somebody's got to step up and say, enough! I love it. Sarah Cedillo, do you know how powerful it would be if you were around a group of girls and you know that some of them are gossips and they don't stop tearing people down or tearing one or two people down? How powerful it would be if you walked over to them as that one who's about to be a senior and you're like, hey, I love you so much. I want you to know that. I love being in fellowship at church with you. I love, man, we're sisters and brothers. I love this. Well, just so you do know, enough. Shut your mouth with the gossip. And lift up praise. Put your hand on the shoulder. Let no unwholesome word come out of your mouth, but only that which is good for the building up of the body. Do you know how powerful that would be, Sarah, if you did that?
Pretty powerful.
Very powerful. Do you know why?
Because
nobody else is really willing to do it. We're like, well, that's just what they do, and they're just this, and they're just that, and make excuses. Enough excuses, people. Enough excuses. Now, again, you know what I did? I didn't say, well, you're a gossip, and you're a this, and you're that. I did not say that. Hello. And again, spiritual leader, spiritual authority. You follow what I'm saying. Some of you older girls, you have no idea the older authority you have over some of the younger girls that they listen to you. Guys, same way. Guys, same way. Some of the authority that they look to you and they just really follow you. And if you stepped up and said, hey, enough, that would actually change a lot. I'm thinking of a deacon from a church. It broke my heart. This deacon, man, he maliciously went after somebody's character with fact. Like there's proof evidence that he did go maliciously about somebody's character. There's facts that he did it. Okay? In the process of doing it, he was spreading it around. What's crazy is other deacons knew it. Pastors knew it. Knew this was taking place. This person that was being maliciously gone after had actually emailed a couple of legal professionals going, okay, some stuff was just gossip, which is wrong, but this kind of took it to another level. What do I need to do to protect myself? Because it was fact. It was something that could have torn down the church. The church body could have been sued. The pastor could have been sued, the head pastor. And that deacon could have been sued. And it would have been settled out of court. Here's the issue that broke my heart in that whole situation for that person. It was actually for that deacon. All those ones who knew the truth and who would say to your face, well, they're doing this wrong. It's so wrong. Do you know that not one of them went and said, Mr. So-and-so, do you understand? We all have this evidence. You know it. He admitted to a couple of things straight out. We have it. You've got to stop because it's not of Christ. You've got to stop because it's not of Christ. I believe with all my heart that man would have stopped. I believe with all my heart that man would have repented. That man would have made it right with the one that he was going after. He would have made it right to his fellow deacons. I believe with all my heart. So my heart actually breaks for that person because nobody stepped up in love, to say, hold up. And here's what John teaches in 3 John. You can dance with this all you want, but I'm just telling you, it's coming out of the scriptures. So take it up with Jesus, all right? He says, I will address this. I will address this. Not in a bully form. Not in a pharisaical form. In love. In love, I want to address it. Why don't we do that too? We need to be like that in the right manner. Granted, spiritual authorities, stuff like that. But these are the kind of people that are like not wanting anybody else around. Our church is big enough. Those kind of comments, those kind of cracks. We don't want anybody coming in and continue to spread the gospel and get that stuff out there. No. This is my friend zone time. Well, thankful that you made the cut, I guess, to get Jesus the salvation that you got in. Hello. All right. There's no limit, man. Anybody come in to spread the gospel? The clear gospel. We encourage that. And we need to be willing to be like those people who are willing to go out and serve. But I love this in verse 11, and this is where I want to camp for a minute. Yeah, a lot of this is real simple, real plain. Verse 11, dear friend, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. Anyone who does what's good is from God, and anyone who does what's evil hasn't even seen God. You out living in evil, you haven't even seen God's what he's saying. Imitate what is good. And I love how he immediately then gave an illustration using Demetrius. This is good. It's kind of like, you really want to know how to live? This person's not walking the way they need to be walking. But I want to make sure you do know. People are like, I don't read the Bible sometimes because it's really hard for me to understand. Okay, I'll give you that. There are some parts of the Bible absolutely hard to understand. Start with things like Colossians 3:17 about things. Well, starting with the whole chapter of Colossians 3. These are things that you put to death in your life. And these are things that you clothe yourself. Real simple. Do I have to tell you how to put on your shirt? Do I? Most of you, it seems like you did an okay job putting your shirt on today. You look all right. You got it under control. Okay, good job. Put those things on. You know if you're walking out in love, right? Let's go back to the basic simple word that we've been talking about, the walking in all this time. Walk in love. Because guys, this is what fellowship is about. We're called to be a fellowship. What are you doing about fellowship? Are you imitating what is good or imitating what is evil? Are you letting the enemy get a foothold in the fellowship of Christ? Or are you turning around and, man, I'm imitating what is good. I'm doing what I can. Hear me. This is scripture. What are you doing? And those of you, even especially as you're getting older, but you know what? Hello, freshman, don't play. Don't let anyone down on you because you're young, but man, set an example. Your life and your faith and your love and your speech and your purity. Set an example. Okay? So hear me on that. Hear me. Oh, but you don't need to worry about your phones right now. We're good. You don't even need to worry about looking out. We're good. We're way good. Okay? Moving on with that. They didn't get it. You're good. Hear me. Don't miss this. Okay? Y'all. The fellowship of believers, who we are, needs to be based in this fact of walking in all the love that John has talked about, walking in the righteousness he's talked about. And guys, living it out. If you are not part of, now catch this whole, listen to this whole thing so you don't take it out of context. If you are living in a manner that is a disruption to the fellowship, you bad mouthing somebody left and right. You turn around, I don't like this, I don't like that. You know what? You need to check yourself at the altar of Jesus Christ. Because it's not about what we like. It's about are we looking at him. You follow what I'm saying? It's not about what somebody else does or doesn't do. It's about what are you doing for the cause of the gospel. You follow what I'm saying? We get all wrapped up in different random things that we forget. Man, get back to this love. Get back to imitating what is good. And you older ones, show what is good. Be that example. We all need examples. You complain about somebody else's example? Fine. Be the better one. You follow that. It's real easy to talk smack about somebody else because you don't like their example. Guess what? Usually somebody that's talking about somebody else's example that they don't like, usually they're not living the better example. Because the one who's living the better example usually figures out, I don't have to point out the wrong example. I know that I better be the good example so that people see me, they're seeing what you ought to be like in Christ. I don't have to judge or throw the other person down. I can be that example. So if you're that one that you want to be negative, you want to be whatever, hear me out of love. Hear this and grab this tonight. Go back to what we talked about even during worship. If you've been lavished in his love, if he has turned on poured into you and you realize I've come to his love and I want to walk in that freedom now, don't put chains back on you. If you want to be somebody that changes what things look like, then guess what? Start living it out right this moment. And be wise, everybody. Do not be judgmental, but be wise. If they're doing things that are contrary to the gospel, we all sin and fall short of the glory of God. Praise God for grace. If they're doing things contrary to the gospel and obviously not changing it, You might want to put yourself closer to those that are living out the gospel. That's just for your sake, because bad company will turn around and spoil who you are in your faith. It's fact. Be the example of what to be. Be the example of what to be. Do you hear me? I love how John finishes it out and comes back in just like last week. I've much to write to you, but I don't want to do so with pen and ink. I hope to see you soon, and we'll talk face to face. Peace to you. The friends here send their greetings. Greet the friends there by name. Dude, he goes back to fellowship. It's all about that brother. It's all about that fellowship being together. You know, I think about the Acts church. And I think about, we talk about this sometimes. I think about why Acts church, why those people just took off in faith. Go to Acts chapter 2 for me, starting in verses 42 to 47. Hey, man, here's what they did. The people in the beginning, hear this, guys, we're almost done. Hear this, soak this in, take this up. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship. You get devoted. They devoted themselves to this, to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of bread. Let's share, build together, let's go, you know, and to prayer. Okay? Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together. How many of the believers? How many? All the believers were together and had everything in common. I'm going to tell you what that looks like in a second. They sold property and possessions to give to anybody who had need. Okay? Every day they continued meeting together in the temple. How often?
Every day.
I'm sorry, this cycle Sunday and Wednesday, right? Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and they ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Do you know why people got saved? They saw God moving in the family. They saw God moving in the house. They saw people that, I'm not checking off my list, I went to church once or twice this week. They're watching people who, man, they just can't wait to be with the body. Why do you want to be with all them people all the time? Oh, man, because we talk about our Savior and what he did for us. And we get to turn around and encourage each other and spur one another on to love and good deeds. Man, to do the things that are right. Man, this world where things are going crazy. Man, I love being around the body because the body continues to encourage me and remind me, no, don't go that way. That's evil. Don't imitate evil. Man, imitate good. So let's continue to go this direction. Who is good? Jesus is the only one that's truly good. And they want to help me do that. That's why I go there. I go there because I feel loved, because the church ought to be the safest house in the place. I'm just telling you. The church ought to be the safest house around. You are, there'll be no person that walks in this place that does not feel like they won't be loved. By the way, that takes all of us to do our part. Hello. Not just 1, 2, 5, 10, 15. That takes all of us to do our part to make sure the people feel loved. That's why the welcome time is so important. Do you hear what I'm saying? But people are on the outside, they're watching this, they're devoted to one another. They weren't sitting there going, well, Kenzie, have you given your part? They were just doing their part. And when they were more focused on what they're supposed to do in Christ, and Kenzie's more focused on what she's supposed to do in Christ, it just kind of all comes together. Like a big old pot of gumbo. Alright? All mixed and mashed and all kinds of stuff up in that soup, but you know what? It's good. Just stirred up. It's good. Well, bring what we have. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? That's the kind of people we gotta be. When John talks about so many times of walking in his truth, of walking in that way, walking in his light, walking in his righteousness, walking in faithfulness, walking in the fellowship that we're in, walking in love. Hear what I'm saying to you. People know this. Do you know that we're called in Galatians, I believe it's 6:10, but I could be wrong. Is it 6:10? Is that right?
Yes.
Galatians 6:10. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially those that belong to the family of believers. What are you doing good for everybody else in this house? And that's not a negative smack. Hear me on that. That's a question to you. Not necessarily need to be answered out loud right now. But hear me. What are you doing good? What are you bringing to the table? Because we're all called to bring something to the table. That's not your excuse. I'm not really bringing anything to the table, so I'm going to go ahead and leave because I'm not bringing anything to the table. No, what that is saying is, if you're not bringing something to the table, but you're a Christ follower, then guess what? Bring something to the table. Don't run away. Step up. Do you follow what I'm saying? Do you follow what I'm saying, guys? Step up. If I'm stepping on your toes right now because you're like, well, I just don't feel like doing that. I'm not called to do this. I'm not called to do that. I already told you. You may not be called to go to Uganda, but guess what? You're still called to serve. You may not be called to do all the deed, but let me be crystal clear. You are still called to serve, and you are still called to lead because there's always people behind you. Everybody's got somebody following. You may not be called specifically to something, But I guarantee you, because you're not called to something, it's because you are called to something else. But you're not going to know what you're called to if you're not talking to the Father about it and then being willing to submit your life. We talked to our seniors on Sunday, and I told one of them, I said, what if God turned around and told you, you know what, you're not going to college with your brother. You kind of always wanted to go. You've never thought about anything different. What if God said, you're not going to that college? I'm actually going to call you way over there. Would you be willing to say, okay, that's what God wants. That's cool. That's cool. And it was cool having that conversation with that senior. Senior on the come out, because I think about it in the scriptures when he talks about, we brought this up too. He says, you know, any man who puts his hands to the plow, looks back, he's not fit for the kingdom of God. Jesus says that. I'm telling you right now, don't lose your salvation. Your hands are still on the plow. Hear me. Look, catch this. Land in with this. Hear me. If you're not doing, and you're a Christ follower, step up. It's time to do. And don't wait for somebody else to do for you. Step up and do. And if you're like, I really don't know what I can do, then the first thing you do, yes, you pray to God about it, and then you come to us, and we'll talk with you. We'll try to figure out, hey, what do you like? What do you not like? We'll work something out with you. You are a part of the body if you're a Christ follower, so therefore I guarantee you, you have a use. You have something good about you. Anybody who's a Christ follower, I ain't talking about this church, I'm talking about any Christ follower. Any Christ follower who has Jesus living in their life, guess what? They're a part of the body of Christ. They have value and they have use. By the way, just so you know, you may think you've got it all. Obviously, there's some people that have a use too, so bring them along. Find out what theirs is. You follow what I'm saying, guys? I love how John takes this and just lines out these three letters. He wants to meet them in person. He wants to talk to them in person. But church, hear this, guys. Hear this. It goes back to the love and walking in it, not sitting in it, walking in it. Walking in it. How are you loving? Love is not focused on what other people are doing. Love is focused on what you can bring to them, how you can turn around and give to them, how you can love them, encourage them, breathe life into them. That's what love is. Go back to 1 Corinthians 13 and check that out. See what he's telling you to do. What are you bringing? I don't care if you are a senior or if you're a freshman. I don't care if you live in some random apartments or you live in the most 40-20 house that there is. I could care less where you live. I could care less if you're an only child that always gets everything you want. Or man, you want a 50 and you feel like, I don't even know my parents know my name. Half the time they go through the roll call and even get the pets in there before they get my name. I don't care. If you're a Christ follower, you have a use and you have a value and you need to bring it to the table. So I want to encourage you tonight. What are you bringing to the table? Imitate. Imitate good. Do you hear me? And not just when you're here on Wednesday. And not just when you're here on Sunday. Desire to want to be together. What you got? What's mine is yours. What's yours? I mean, it's all good. Hey, let's go. It's all good. You need something? I got it? Okay. You can have it. Done. Check. Can you imagine that kind of fellowship, guys? I want to imagine that kind of fellowship. I want to be somebody who leads the way with that. And I would love nothing more than have everybody right here leading that way with me. You follow what I'm saying? I want to be one of those people that people are talking about me behind my back. If they're talking the truth, it's stuff that people were talking about Guy is to John too. I want to be like that. Are you reminding people that they're loved? Are you praying for people and praying for them specifically? And letting them know that. Letting them know that. Not for your attention, but so that they know that somebody's praying for them. Are you talking about others in a very positive manner? Building them up to others of what they've done in Christ. And are you making sure that those people also, that they have been built up in Christ? Let's start with those. You watch us really walk in love in a manner worthy of the gospel. You watch Christ do amazing things. Yes, there you guys. How sweet is that he does that? Father, thank you so much for your love. And I pray that you would continue to stir that love in us, help us be what you desire us to be. That we might start to look, continue to grow and look. I think this group does an amazing job with a lot of things. That we would continue to grow in being like that Acts church. We don't think about it often when we're in church. We're just living out the gospel. We're being together. Loving you, loving your name, loving living for you. Encouraging those that you've made. Help us not be like Diotrephes, but more like Gaius, Demetrius. Help us be like them. Help us love, as John's example was, help us to love like Jesus. And may others see that. May they begin to taste and see how good you are because of it. We love you, Lord God. We give all this to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you, mean it. Have a good night.